Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the City of Salinas Council meeting. The City Council met in closed session in the City Manager's Conference Room at 304. Present were myself and all of the council members. We discussed a performance evaluation and labor government code section 54957 and 54957.6, public employee performance evaluations and labor relations with unrepresented employee, i.e. the city manager. The council, no action was taken at this time or direction given to staff. The other item discussed was the public employee appointment under the government code section of 54957B1, city attorney. Council member action. The council voted 5-2 vote and appointed Christopher A. Callahan as the city attorney. Subject to final review and approval of an employment agreement, an open session on January the 7th. Voting for it were Councilwoman Lutz, Councilwoman De La Rosa, Councilmember Barrera, Councilwoman Craig, and myself as the mayor. Voting no were Councilmember Castaneda and McShane. We will now go into the City Council, City of Champions, and I will go to Councilmember We did the pledge when we opened originally. We will now go to the City Councilmember McShane for his City of Champions.
A lot of stuff over here, and I know many of you are waiting for the results of the 2013 holiday home lighting competition that took place here in our great city on Sunday. Before we get to that, I want to acknowledge a man that's done great deeds for Salinas, in particular Old Town, as a business owner and leader in the community and a good friend. We can celebrate that in Old Town, now on the 200 block, the passageway that connects the city lot kind of next to Grapes and Grain and Casa Sereno has been expanded as folks go to the 200 block on in Old Town Salinas. And responsible for that is the man we're going to honor tonight. And to just sort of clarify what was going on, basically you had a piece of land that didn't have any sort of sewer hookup, utilities issues, and quite a bit of vandalism. It was an area that, as it was left vacant with remodeling to the existing business next door, that just was unsightly. And thanks to his leadership and the leadership of the city of Salinas, ultimately his generosity in discounting the piece of property has made possible a really, really large and beautiful and useful open space for the public. And I think it's definitely deserving of a great honor for none other than fellow Rotarian and great friend and business leader, Mr. Bob Faramond. So please come forward, Bob, and join us in acknowledging you. If you could just share a little bit about the project and mistletoe with you as you
honorable mayor of Salinas, council members, thank Councilman McShane. Thank you for inviting me to your meeting. Real quickly, in 1977, my brother and I started a restaurant called The Windfall in 200 block of the Main Street. Shortly after we were in business for about 2 years, Downtown Redevelopment Agency bought the building next door and they tore it down, and we were in need of more space because we were fortunate enough to become very popular quickly. And with the help of the Downtown Redevelopment Agency at that time, we purchased about 1,000 square feet of the walkway and added it to the existing building that we had, and remodeled it and made that classroom. And over the next 23 years, which I operated the restaurant, many people enjoyed the space. Thousands of people dined. We have had many happy occasions, birthdays, weddings, celebration, quinceañeras, and so on. After I sold the restaurant and the new owners, they operated for another 9 years and then the place closed. And the present owner of the building, they didn't want that sliver of the land to be attached to their building, and a new person who is putting the new restaurant as we speak. So we thought, myself and my family, we decided, okay, the city of Salinas was very great to us to make this partial possible for many, many years, and it did do its purpose for my family. And the decision was that this partial should go back to the city of Salinas as a gift from us. So the citizens and the visitors who come to our beautiful downtown can enjoy the walkway and the beauty of our downtown. And as many of you know, I owned a restaurant in Carmel for many, many years. So I come from the other side of the hill. But don't ever discount our beautiful city. It is a great city, and there's a lot of opportunities for a lot of businesses, especially in downtown area. So I want to thank you for inviting us, and thank you for your kind word, and best wishes.
Let's give him a round of applause. With Mr. Faramond is his son, John, who owns Balance Physical Therapy. He was reminding me of some of the stories as a busser and a waiter there. You've done so much for the community. And for those of you, again, the 200 block, Lincoln, that's just going to be a great, great opportunity. Please join us up here on the dais. We have an award for you, Mr. Faramond, as you can come on up. Thank you. Mayor, should we go into the holiday home lighting? Is that okay? So this is our fourth year doing a citywide holiday home lighting competition. I've had the pleasure of playing a role. This is an event sponsored by the Salinas Neighborhood Council. Lighting your house or business is really a sign of community spirit. It builds collaboration with neighbors and even some competitive spirit. And I think we really captured that. With us tonight, we have Hunter Harvath with Monterey Salinas Transit, who's going to come down, and also Mel Godwin. She is the newly, come on down to the podium, if you will, elected president of the Salinas Neighborhood Council. And just walking the doorway, perfect, Dawn Mathis, you're coming to the podium there from PG&E. So these are our sponsors. And if you guys just want to say a couple of quick words, that would be great. A little bit about the competition and your role as a sponsor. Mel, join us here, please.
I'll go first. Hi, Hunter Harvath. I'm Assistant General Manager for Finance Administration for Monterey Salinas Transit. We were pleased to be a sponsor for this holiday home lighting contest this year. It was our first year of participating. When I was approached by, I believe, Councilmember Craig, as well as some of the other council members, it sounded like a really fun and community-building activity for us to be a part of. We already are a sponsor of the Salinas Holiday Parade of Lights, and so this seemed like a natural add-on for that. It's very inspiring to see all the community support for this, and maybe next year you'll see some Christmas lights over at the Salinas Transit Center. You've inspired us for next year.
Cool.
So thank you.
Great.
So I have notes because I get very nervous. So I'm Melissa, Salinas Neighborhood Council incoming president, and we partially sponsored along with you guys. We had a huge turnout. It was wonderful. We had, I think, three different buses that went over 80 different participants and judges that judged all of the wonderful houses that were out there. Great holiday spirit. So we want to thank every participant, every sponsor, and just all of our neighbors that came together and put out their true holiday spirit for this competition. Mm-hmm. So thank you, guys.
Thank you, Melissa.
Dawn Mathis, PG&E. I take care of government relations here locally.
This is really a wonderful example of how our energy at PG&E, together with the community's energy, can create something truly special. So I just would like to thank all of the members of the community, our sponsors, everyone who's dedicated their energy, their dedication, their time to making it happen and making it possible. It's our honor to support.
Thank you. To the mayor, Councilwoman Craig, Councilmember Barrera, Councilmember Castaneda, myself, these buses had the council members actively engaged. 65 homes, 4 zip codes. You could imagine navigating some of the streets of Salinas. And indeed, the competition was stiff. So we have certificates from the county, from the city, and checks as well. Because that power bill is a little bit much. And for those that want the bragging rights, of course, signs for the front yard. So I'm going to ask maybe Hunter and Melissa and Dawn if you can. I'll just hand these down to you. You can help. Equally impressive with the lights are the people behind the lights. Imagine what type of human being it takes to really bedazzle their house or business. And you're going to meet some of these characters in just a few moments. So, best house overall, we're going to start with second place. And this place featured a singing Santa, eggnog, cookies, and plenty more. And that's none other than kind of our premier senior home and establishment, and that's Via Sara. We have Greg Becker, the general manager, and Tiffany as well from Via Sara. Please come to the podium as we award you with second place overall.
Well, thank you, Mayor. Thank you, City Council members. It was a great honor for us to do this for the city of Salinas. Our residents at Villa Sara, we have over 135 residents that live there, and they were so intrigued to do this for the city because they always want to give back. And so they were much as part of this as much as my management staff. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Steve.
Awesome. Thank you. Now, the next award is the Griswold Award, and some folks have never seen Christmas Vacation. If you haven't, it's worth seeing. This is the house that has just a lot going on, and truly some interesting creative components. On North in Cambrian Drive in North Salinas, you can't miss this place. Rich, why don't you come on down as we recognize you with the Griswold Award. Come on down and say a few words. Get $100 there and a couple of certificates. Cool. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your creative endeavor there?
Well, my name is Rich Ramsdell, and apparently I have a problem. I'm going to need an intervention at some point, so you guys can come to the house and have me sit down and talk about it. But seriously, no, this is something that, you know, as a kid growing up, this is something that I wish we could have done growing up, you know, in our house. But now I've got an opportunity to do it for not only myself, but the community and everybody around me. I mean, I think it's great. You know, people ask, you know, why do you do it? I do it for me. I do it for everybody that wants to come and enjoy it. I mean, I think it's a really good community thing. It brings people together. And I think, you know, the more that we have, the better city of Salinas is going to be, I think, you know, so. I appreciate everybody that came out, anybody that comes by and looks at it. You know, that's why I do it. I do it for, you know, for everybody. You know,
a showstopper. Thousands of lights, winter wonderland theme. And it was really, it was awesome. So why don't you come on up
here? I appreciate
the dais,
that.
And we have a wonderful placard for the front yard to award you with. So. Category was one that PG&E added, the energy efficiency category, and this year it was easy, and I'll tell you, also extremely beautiful, and I even have a few cookies left that I thought I'd pass down to the mayor. They had these wonderfully decorated gingerbread cookies. I mean, it's just so neat to be kind of welcomed like that. And so where are the towels at? Are they here? Okay, great. Nicole, and come on down, guys. This is wonderful. Tell us a little bit about your apparatus you put out there. There was
we didn't realize we were going to be getting into this, but by the end of it, we had over 95% of our lights were all LED or solar powered. It was just an easier way for us to go. We put them on timers. They run on off-peak hours, and I don't think there was one day that we had when we were setting up that the neighbors didn't come by and you know, thank us for bringing the spirit to the neighborhood, and many of them put lights out for the first time in years. So it's really inspiring to, you know, get together as a community and do this, and thank you all for putting the contest together and coming by and doing the buses and everything. We really enjoyed it.
Awesome.
Thank you very much.
Well, come on down here, and we'll congratulate you. Last but not least, the most beautifully decorated holiday home in Salinas. This was coveted, trust me. We had so many ballots, it was just incredible. And of course there were cookies and a star hung so high, I don't know who climbed those birch trees. None other than Rose and Dave Clark. Come on down once again.
Well, thank you very, very much to all of you, to the city of Salinas for putting this on. Needless to say, it would be an understatement that I love Christmas. But having said that, to put a smile on people's faces when they walk by, or the buses that came by, there were so many worthy people out there that did beautiful homes. One of the ones that stuck to my head was one when we were in the East Salinas area, and we were driving by one of the streets. I know you didn't notice because you were talking with somebody else, but there was this little house in the back of all the hustle and bustle of the east side. Must have been a second unit, but it was decorated so beautifully, and the people had so much pride in what they had done, and that's what it's all about. Christmas inside your heart, that you continue doing it, not for us, but for the generations to come. Thank you, council members, for being there. Thank you to all of you. It's a pleasure to be part of Salinas.
A rose to you, your husband, and your daughter Crystal's here, and all the other elves that helped. Thank you and congratulations.
They are my big elves. Thank
you. Come on down, please.
Councilmember Castaneda.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. I spoke to these individuals for their great dynamic work that they're doing citywide here in the city of Salinas. I think we need more of that, just as we're continuing with the pride of our city. It's underreported from our media, so I think this is a great opportunity to do this before the city as we televise this live. So what we need to do is to continue the trend that we have with the city council members. We all know our constituents very well, and it's great. It's great to share the great news out there. If we can have Mr. Joshua Alfaro, if you can come with your young students to the dais, please, and bring your team forward. Willow, if you'd like to join them as well. I chose Mr. Joshua Alfaro because it was probably less than a year that I met him. When I met him, just his spirit and his motivation was focused on doing something that many other people probably has not thought of. I think I'm a strong believer in the music, dance, theater, and arts. Those are all God-given talents that we need to exercise, not only in this city, but everywhere that we can go and touch our feet on. I think Mr. Alfaro not only is an example, but he knows how to take action. In less than a year, he's taken a dream of his, because he's also belonged to a drumline. He's done national competition with the drum corps. His music talents range from a wide variety. And I think with your other co-teacher as well, Mr. Javier Tamayo, unfortunately he's not here today, he's on travel, but the LSL Center for Fine Arts under Willow Ray's direction and leadership has sponsored these children. And not to leave other key folks and stakeholders that have given to them as well. I believe the Salinas Rotary have also given money to them so they can repair instruments and they can go ahead and get prepped for a January 29th showing or so forth. So that's an event that we want to attend. Joshua, thank you for doing and impacting the work and teachings in the Alisal. It's not only impacting in a positive manner the Alisal, but it's also being affected in a positive manner citywide. And I'd like to go ahead and present you along with Willow Array and Javier Tamayo. And if you can bring your students, you can go ahead and take the podium there and share anything that I may have left out. But other than that, I really appreciate your presence, especially the young students. I know they're on winter break, so it was a bit more of a demand as far as outside of the normal schedule. So not everyone is present, but I think that small number will definitely shake the roof of this place.
Definitely. Thank you. Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor and council members. This is kind of a bit of a surprise. I really didn't know that I was going to be receiving awards. I thought that you guys wanted us to come play and just kind of show off a little bit, so we're prepared to do that. But I moved out here about over a year ago with a purpose, and that was definitely to share my talents. I've been pretty fortunate. I went to some pretty good schools. I had some music programs, and I've just always wanted to share since. We have our students here, but before we do that, I'd like to introduce Ms. Willow Ray. She's the Executive Director for Alisal Center for the Fine Arts, and she has a few words. Thank you.
I just want to say thank you to the City of Salinas for the amazing amount of collaboration that you guys offer us. Working with Ms. Kristen and Ms. Sheila has been so beneficial. They've helped to guide our center and the proper steps that we need to take to be able to provide these kids with services. So thank you all so much for the work that you do. Thank you for investing in the East Alisal. It really is an amazing community, and the arts are making it even more amazing every single day. We work out of the bread box, so we get to share that partnership with the city as well, and we're very thankful for that space, and our families and our students are very thankful to have that space to work out of. We have 6-7 different programs right now, and in the future, we're looking to open our programs during the day to also serve the adults in the community, so that's kind of the direction that we're headed. We want to keep programming open for the youth in the evenings, and then for the elderly, the women who are present in the community during the day, so that's kind of our goal. We're a nonprofit organization, so we rely on grants. All of our performances are free. All of our programs are free. So thank you guys for your support. Thank you guys for having us here. And our kids are amazing. I think our percussion serves around 60 youth. We're also in Chispa communities as well. And then we have theater. We have 2 theater programs. We have Aztec dance programs. We have visual arts programs. And we have La Milpa programs. So we're thrilled to be here, thrilled to show our kids. And thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Willow. Thank you, Joshua. Before I move forward to the Salinas City Council commending and congratulating you, do you want to introduce the students? And I know you can manage the time, but from there, you're a music instructor. So you want to pass them and introduce them to the council?
Okay, so we have Miss Natalie Blancarte here and her sister, Chanel Blancarte. And yes, give my hand, please. We have young Abel Garnica and Andres Garnica, and their other brother, Joel Garnica. He has strep throat today, otherwise he'd be here, but we have another set of family here. We have Mr. Leo Montano, very talented young recorder player, French horn player, and drummer as well. He's a member of our Alisal Percussion Program and YoSal. And his brother is doing some community service right now, but he plays the tenor drums right here with Miss Natalie, so he's not able to join us right now. And in the back, we have Miss Emily and Jolene Enriquez and sisters as well. So before we play a little something here, again, we're serving right now in Salinas, we're serving about 60 kids combined with musicians from Greenfield. We're serving about 80, and that's just through Al-Sal Center for the Fine Arts. Myself and Mr. Tamayo, we also work with Al-Sal Union School District at Cesar Chavez and Dr. Oscar F. Loya, where we're teaching about 200 musicians percussion instruments and music basics. And I also work with Madonna del Sasso School. We just started a drum line there. We did our first parade this past a few weeks ago, Festival of Lights. And I also spent a little time with Monterey High School. One of my old students is a band director there. So yeah, we're pretty busy. Actually, the instruments that Monterey High School uses, these young musicians here, we got some grant money from the Steinbeck Rotary Club. And our students, we use that money to fix up some of their drums, to fix up our drums. And there's a lot of momentum, I think, that we have, and we're just going to keep on going with that. So thank you for having us here. And so now, students, if you could please pick up your instruments. We're going to play a few things for you here. Normally, we have two tenor drums here. Those are the multi-toms. And we usually have about four snares, the snare drums right here. We usually have about five bass drums, and we have two cymbals right now. Goal for us in the future is to get a trailer, to get some uniforms. These uniforms is something that we did a few fundraisers at Casa Sereno, and so this is what we have for right now. We've performed performed at the Kitty Capers Parade, the West End Festival. We performed for the Monterey County of Education. We had a television performance there, Veterans Day Parade, several fundraisers at Casa Sereno. We had six programs at the Festival of Lights Parade. We did an Al-Sal High School soccer game. There's an amazing soccer team over there, so we went to go drum for them last week, and just a few days ago, we drummed for the Al-Sal Union School District after-school football, flag football program, so we took our drum line, some of these drum members and kids from the two schools in Al-Sal Union School District, so we're having a blast, and again, thank you guys so much for your support. Okay, so now we're going to start with an exercise. It's called 8-8-16. It's a warm-up exercise.
If anyone seen Joshua Alfaro and it looks familiar, he performed on American Idol. So I just wanted to throw that out there.
Yeah.
Close, we're going to play our cadence. We've been working on this cadence for a few months. We performed it several times at the Harvest Festival, again, Veterans Day Parade, and the Salinas Parade of Lights.
join them on this one. I hope you guys don't mind. We have a set of two brothers and sisters that live in the seaside. They come out to our classes, but they're already out of town. So I'll be playing bass drum. Here we go. Cadence.
There's plenty more of that to come in the future. Our goal is to create a drum and bugle corps here for the city of Salinas, and we'd really like to continue the work, hopefully with your support, and eventually travel to Northern California, the state of California, eventually the country. And you guys might not know it yet, but you are tomorrow's leaders.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much,
Mr. Joshua Alfaro, with your students as well as Willow Arabe, you can join the Salinas City Council. We commend and congratulate you. I know within due time, you're going to put Salinas on the map in nationwide competition for drumline and drum corps. Thank you for what you do. Anyone out there that strongly believes or did not believe, please support your local music, dance, theater, arts programs here in the city of Salinas. $20,000 in 1 year can go ahead and multiply what we see here 10, 20-fold. So thank you, excellent instructor. Come forward and we congratulate them as City of Champions. Thank you, Mayor. In light of time, if we can call St. James. Where are you at, St. James? Can you come forward? Sister Minister Carrie Silas, and if you can bring those with you as well that strongly support what St. James has done. As they come forward, this is the other selection that I've had for the City of Champions. I'm very proud of meeting them. They have done an excellent work. You don't need a large team to make an impact in this city. You can do it with a very small team, as long as they're dedicated in what they truly believe in. And that's what we have here in St. James CME Church. I wanted to go ahead and congratulate your efforts, recognize you before the city council. I know that every third Sunday, you guys go out to Soledad Street, and you have a feeding that goes on, as well as every Saturday you cater to the community. You started off with about 17 or 18 families, and now it's grown to 80, moving over to about 100 families. You're off of Calle Cebu. Believe it or not, somehow they've made it also to impact the East Salinas area. And the East Salinas area now is also joining with them to make a larger impact in the city of 153,000 people. I know that in your and your team of different ministries, from prison to Soledad, dealing with homelessness. You have people attending from Richmond, all the way from Richmond coming to Salinas. People coming from San Jose, Hayward, King City. They come here, not the shopping or the dining or the playing experience. They actually come here to do outreach work in the city, and I think it's very important for us to acknowledge that and to know what they're about. And this is just one group out of many out there that we wanted to go ahead and bring forward. But this one really stands out. I gotta tell you that you've also made a major impact in my life and inspired me to do more because of what I see you do in your free time. So Minister Kerry Silas, if you can introduce your group. I know that the Reverend Dr. Cedric Kane is here with you as well as some other members. And if I left anything out, please feel free to fill it in. Thank you.
I want to thank the City Council and Jose Castaneda, awesome man of God, and I really appreciate meeting him. We reach out to the community and we feed the people because we can no longer, my brothers and sisters, take a blind eye to the starving people that's in the streets. And we must come together as a people to stamp out this cause, this hunger, this homelessness that's going on. There's no need for anyone in America to be hungry. So I want to introduce to you to the pastor of our church, Reverend Dr. Kane. And he can introduce you.
To the city council members, to the mayor, and to all that are present, I want to thank you for acknowledging Minister Silas and the Ministry of St. James. One of the things that is blatant and running rampant is the reality of homelessness in this rather tough socioeconomic climate. People are losing their homes, they're losing their jobs, and something as simple as preparing a meal for someone that is less fortunate can leave an indelible mark upon the lives of those individuals who have been impacted with the reality of homelessness. We at St. James, we're not doing this to be recognized. We're doing it because there's a need. And we are, to the best of our ability, following the commandments of Jesus the Christ. So we thank you all for acknowledging our efforts. We have Sister Pam Weston here with us. We have Elder Tavia Harang. We have Minister Randy Cruz. We have Sister Tish in the back, Minister Green, Sister Green, and little brother Sion, Sister Monica, Sister Dorothy, and brother Sean. I always call him his nephew. So we're here, and we will continue the work. We thank you for your support. It is a labor of love, and we're not tired yet. Councilman Castaneda, you mentioned that people are coming from as far as Richmond. I live in Concord, California, and I pastor here in Salinas, and it is a joy to work, to go to Soledad Street, to pass out blankets, to pass out fresh water, to pass out food, to pass out jackets. It's a joy for us. And so we solicit your support. Thank you for validating our efforts, and may God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. If we can go ahead and get this everyone with you to come forward. I want to go ahead and announce the Salinas City Council to commend and congratulate St. James CME Church and for your cheerful giving and for your great example you set here in the city. Thank you. Thank you, Mayor.
Well, that's pretty awesome. We are now going to move to a presentation and Salinas Police Department SWAT armored rescue vehicle. We're going to receive a presentation, obviously from the Chief of Police, assisted by Officer Dale Forrest.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, ladies and gentlemen of the council. I just want to take a moment and introduce Detective Forrest to you. I'm not going to steal any of his thunder. You'll see the remarkable work that he's done. I hope you got a chance to go out and visit the armored rescue vehicle that we've procured. It's quite an amazing tool, but I want to introduce to you Detective Forrest. You've seen him around. If you've paid attention to our award ceremonies and our Officer of the Year ceremonies, Dale's a presence at all of those consistently. He is a phenomenal SWAT operator, a phenomenal detective, and a phenomenal Salinas police officer. He took this project on well over a year ago on his own. When he brought the idea to me, I kind of rolled my eyes and said, yeah, go ahead, Dale. And lo and behold, here it sits, because that's the kind of guy Dale is. I honestly didn't think we were going to get it. So if you look at that behemoth out front in the category of careful what you wish for, you'll see what happens. I'll leave the introduction with this. Dale Forrest is the most decorated Salinas police officer on duty today in the city. As far as I know, he is the most decorated police officer in the history of the Salinas Police Department, certainly since my tenure. We have hung more medals and awards on this young man than any other police officer. He is truly phenomenal. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Detective Dale Forrest.
Well, thank you, Chief, for the introduction. I really appreciate it, and good evening to you all. I appreciate you letting me speak to you today. Hard act to follow up, a lot of great people that went before me, so thank you to all of them for supporting the community as well. Like the Chief said, today I'm here to present you our new armored vehicle, and I put together a brief PowerPoint presentation to be able to explain it a little bit easier. Hopefully we can go this pretty quickly for you. In going over the department SWAT team a little bit, I wanted to just do a brief overview of what we do. We respond to critical incidents, pre-planned search warrants, and occasionally assist the Sheriff's Department and other agencies with operations that they may conduct, such incidents as hostage rescue incidences or barricaded subjects. Possibly an active shooter, which we're seeing all across the nation, those incidents are rising every day. So we face a lot of threats on a day-to-day basis responding to these types of incidents. In order to respond to those incidents, we had an old armored vehicle that we've had for 10 plus years on the team. It's been there since I've been there. Outdated, was rusting, had leaks and water leaks. We looked for replacement parts for it over the years. Couldn't find any. Tried to do everything that we could to it, put duct tape on it and made it work for what we had to do. So the search began to try to replace that vehicle, and we looked through many different avenues to be able to try to do that. And the old armored vehicle that we had provided very limited ballistic protection. It'll only stop small arms fire, very small handgun caliber rounds. Most rifles that are out there on the street would have went right through it and could have struck our officers or members of the community if we had been using that to try to protect them. So we needed to try to find something to rectify this situation. The industry standard, looking at all the other departments outside our agency within California and the nation, have been using armored vehicles on all of their teams. One of the industry standards is a Lenco Bearcat. Very expensive. They're from $250,000 to $350,000, depending on what kind of items that you get on there. We would have loved to have bought one of these. It would have been perfect for our team, but given you know, the budgetary situation we have within the city, we knew that that wasn't an option. So we started to try to explore other avenues. over the last couple years, like the chief had mentioned, I've been working on this, trying to find a solution. I wrote a couple of grants through Homeland Security, trying to obtain it through Homeland Security funds. Unfortunately, I was denied on both of those grants because they had allocated the money elsewhere. So at that point, I found out that we were a part of the 1033 program, which is a military program to provide military equipment to governmental agencies that they were no longer using. And that equipment was provided for free to those agencies. It was very hard to come by because it's first come, first serve basis. So you're kind of scrounging along trying to find what you can. Many years back, about 10 years ago, we were able to acquire some patrol rifles for our patrol officers through this program. And the program kind of fell off the map for a while. So I decided to take on the project of getting this program back up and running and trying to find us some equipment. About a year and a half ago, I put in an armored vehicle request to the 1033 program. And about 3 months ago, they got back to me. I was sitting at my desk, got a phone call, and they said, "We have an armored vehicle for you." And I about fell off the chair. So they sent me the pictures, and I said, "There's no way." And I went and talked to Kelly and said, "You're not going to believe what's happening. We need to get this thing right away if we're going to get it to protect our officers and the community better." And he agreed. And we went through the lengthy process of getting it here and getting it for our department. And again, that was given to us at no cost. It was essentially my signature on a piece of paper. So. So just a little bit about the armored rescue vehicle. It was used by the military to provide troops protection from gunfire and explosives. They're encountering a lot of IEDs over there. It is manufactured by International. It's basically a semi-truck chassis and engine with a box on the back that's armor protected. And it's something for us that'll stop any kind of gunfire, keep our officers safe, and keep the community members safe that we're responding to help. And we were awarded it in September of 2013. Myself, Sergeant John Murray, and one of the other officers that was qualified to drive it, Robert Hampson, we went up to Seattle, Washington, and picked this thing up. It was located at Fort Lewis. It was a 2007 model. It only had 7,600 miles on it. We were astonished. It actually had never been deployed overseas. It was used as a training model there at Fort Lewis and only was driven maybe 15 miles a week. It weighs 37,800 pounds. It's a very heavy vehicle, and it requires a Class B license, which we're currently certifying everyone to be able to drive it on the team. These are some of the pictures when we first got it. It was desert tan and had a military setup inside. We obviously needed to do some things to it to make it applicable for the city of Salinas. There were 8 acquired by law enforcement agencies within the state of California. About 70 to 80 of them went across the country. And our department was the first department to receive one in the state of California. And I don't have any factual basis for it yet, but we believe it was the first in the nation because of how quickly we acted on getting this vehicle. Ballistic capability is a stop of 50 caliber round. That's a very, very large round. We're going to be hard-pressed to find any kind of weapon that's going to defeat this armor, so we're pretty safe in this thing. It's 4x4, can transport about 8 to 10 of us, and it has everything on it that we could imagine, and it all came with it. Just to go over the cost a little bit again, $0. It was a $658,000 vehicle for the military, and we got it for free. I was able to obtain through the Office of Emergency Services. Our partners over there were gracious enough to help us out with painting it through grant funds, so we didn't spend any money on the paint. It was about $1,350 to go down and pick it up for gas, food, lodging. Spent about another $2,800 on emergency lighting. So our total cost was about $4,150 to get this vehicle up and running, and it's now available within the city. This is the way the vehicle looks now. It was sitting outside just a little bit ago. As you can see in the interior, we gained some equipment for it to try to update it to what we needed. Took some seating out of new patrol cars that we had acquired out of the rear seats because they've been traded out for plastic ones for prisoners. So I decided that we could reutilize those and place them into the back and make some brackets for them and use basically what we could to save money. So we made it to fit our needs, and it's coming along. So since we've got it, there's actually been several incidences where this exact same vehicle has been used. One of them was an incident in Roseville, California. There was three officers that were actually shot by a parolee at large during the time they were trying to apprehend him. There was a long standoff with him inside of a house, and Citrus Heights Police Department, who acquired the exact same vehicle, actually rolled theirs out to that incident, and it was used as the primary vehicle for that situation, and it came to a peaceful resolution with him surrendering. There was also another incident down in Gardena, California, where an armed gunman on a bus had shot several people, and they had deployed this as well, and that also ended up in a peaceful resolution once it arrived on scene. So it is applicable to what we're doing as a law enforcement agencies, and it is being used by several across the nation for violent instances that are happening. Just recently, also, I noted that we, in the city of Salinas, responded on a search warrant, and during that search warrant, we actually discovered an incendiary device, which was located within the home. And if we would have had this vehicle at that time, we could have placed this vehicle in between us and community members, which we had evacuated to prevent any injuries from any kind of blast. So there's definite applicability to this vehicle and having it. And in closing, as I stated before, it's going to provide our team and the community with a greater protection and capabilities. And it can be used to also rescue people in a multitude of incidents during either active shooter situations or other situations where people may have already been shot. We can place this in between us and the suspects and essentially rescue those people and render first aid or help as much as that we can. I didn't list it on here, but we can run the gamut. I mean, you could have natural disasters, and we could end up delivering supplies with this vehicle. It's very large. We could assist mobile field force in civil unrest. A multitude of incidents that we could respond with this and our partners within the community to try to resolve situations. So it will definitely save lives in the future. So thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Okay, we will now go to council member for questions. Councilwoman Craig.
Great job, Detective Forrest. I've had the privilege, when you were on patrol, of doing a ride-along with you. I will brag on your behalf that you've been the Officer of the Year not only once but twice for the department, and I commend you for constantly being proactive and always looking for a solution to things. It's very easy to get discouraged when you work for the city of Salinas, and I really commend you. I do. I mean, there's great truth to that, you know. It is.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
You're welcome. Two questions, and actually, they're kind of softball questions for you, but what are you doing with the old SWAT vehicle?
The old vehicle, we looked at several different options. We were able to find a resolution of having it essentially scrapped, and we're going to be able to gain monies from that. We found A&S Metals is going to give us about $1,500 for the old vehicle, which we can actually use to outfit the new one with some more items that we'd like. So we're gonna actually gain a little bit more money there as well, and it'll be disposed of properly.
Great, thank you. And then my second question, you know, I sort of laugh a little bit when Carmel Police Department rolls out their SWAT team, because I think to myself, okay, so not really understanding how many times the SWAT team is used in the city of Carmel, can you perhaps provide some insight on how many times our SWAT team is deployed for the city of Salinas?
Yes. I've been on the SWAT team about 6 years, and we have a lot of critical incidents that we do respond out to. This last year, I believe it was around 16 to 17 times that we were activated. Some of those being either pre-planned search warrants to go look for suspects in different criminal activity, and about half of those being suspect-initiated, where we actually are called out for patrol either having a barricaded suspect or some kind of other critical incident. So we're being deployed out at least once to twice a month, which comparatively to other teams greatly outnumbers what they're doing. The Sheriff's Department, I think, had probably a handful or a little bit more that they went to. So we're definitely very active within the city and relied upon quite a bit.
Great, thank you. That's all.
Councilmember Barrera, any questions? Councilmember De La Rosa, any questions? To my left, Councilwoman Lutz. Councilmember Castaneda, any questions?
Sure, thank you, Mayor. What does it cost to maintain? Maintenance of a normal vehicle can be enormous for a budget, household budget, but what does it cost to maintain this type of SWAT vehicle?
Correct. Well, we looked into that before we wanted to acquire it because that was obviously one of our major concerns. I ensured that our city fleet maintenance staff over at our city yard were able to maintain that vehicle. Since it is an international chassis and engine, they can do all the oil changes, they can do all the kinds of repairs. They actually confirmed for me that most of the parts are over the counter for semi-type vehicles to be able to repair it. We looked at the tire replacement costs. I think they're pretty expensive, about $700 a tire, because they have a run flat system. So if they are shot, they won't go flat. So there are some expenses that can occur with that. But because we are replacing the old SWAT armored vehicle, it is a one for one trade. So it would essentially be the exact same cost as the old vehicle that we're maintaining. In fact, it's probably even less based on the fact that we had to constantly try to repair the old vehicle just to make it run.
Thank you. What's the average cost to deploy that vehicle, whether it's in the city limits or if it's a neighboring city, north or south county of us?
The only cost, at this point, since the vehicle didn't cost us anything, the only cost to, would be for gas. Okay. It gets probably about 8 to 10 miles per gallon, we found out, driving it back from Seattle. Which comparatively to a diesel truck isn't actually too bad. I was expecting about 2 to 4, but it's relatively low cost because we're not going too far. So you figure maybe $100, $150 for gas for there and back. And you know, our officers are already able to deploy and are all will be capable of driving it once we have our Class Bs for it.
Okay, great, thank you.
Councilmember McShane, any questions?
Yeah, sure. I'm equally enthusiastic. Nice work, Dale. I can see the family beaming. It's awesome. There's no doubt this is probably the only resource like this within 100, maybe 200 miles. How do you plan to collaborate? I know a lot of training budgets can be kind of maximized in collaborative type training and use of even materials and equipment like this. I bet you all the guys on the block want to go for a ride. So
definitely.
What's your plan for that?
So actually, since we've had it, and I was trying to get it up and running as quickly as possible, Sergeant Murray actually had recently spearheaded training where our SWAT team, as well as the Sheriff's Department SWAT team and Peninsula SWAT team, had a joint training session together. And we were all able to meet up. They were all able to look at the vehicle. We were able to look at theirs. It was kind of show and tell, meet and greet. It's the first of its kind, and I commend Sergeant Murray for being able to put something like that together, because we're trying to move into a new area where we are all working together because of incidents like active shooter situations where we're going to need more people and we're going to start assisting each other more. Things of that training nature are already happening. We continue to strive to continue that. We're going to look forward to more trainings together. Currently, the SWAT team trains twice a month for 10 hours each training session. We usually have a range day and then also a tactical training day, which we've been allocated for several years. So we take those opportunities to invite our partners from other agencies to join us and continue training with it.
Thank you.
We're now going to go to the public for any public comment on this presentation. Seeing none, we're now going to go back to the council members and they can comment now. Councilmember McShane.
Well, just congratulations, and to the point of joint training. You know, like you said, I think in the day and age of limited government, it's really behooves us to engage the other guys out there so that ultimately we're stronger together against a significant incident. So kudos. Boy, keep it up. And Chief, keep it coming.
Councilmember Castaneda.
No comments. Thank you.
Councilwoman Lutz.
Just very quickly, Chief, you've certainly hired an incredible staff. Thank you for that. Dale, thank you for this presentation. Would have been nice if you introduced your parents, but other than that.
I'd like to actually give them a lot of thanks, especially to my wife. She's very patient with me at being work hour after hour, especially when I should probably be home, and my daughter, Marlene. I appreciate them very much. And my parents are here, my dad, Richard, and mom, Barbara, and my brother, Greg, and his girlfriend, Paula. So thank you to them.
Councilwoman De La Rosa.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Councilmember Barrera.
Detective Forrest, earlier you said somebody else was a hard act to follow, but you know what? You're a hard act to follow.
Thank you.
I mean, for you to come to your chief and your chief says, yeah, go ahead, Dale, do it. I mean, think about that. You know what? In our work, as we always try to improve customer service, we spend several thousand dollars sending people to workshops, including myself. We go out to trainings. But I really believe if we keep an eye on you, we can train to be a better servant leader. Detective Forrest, you're not the most decorated law enforcement officer just because you are. It's because you earned it. And I really appreciate how you said all it took was your signature. That's your integrity. That's your word. That's how this government really believed in what you were doing. And I commend you for your good work. I commend your parents for raising a great man such as yourself. And I'm humbled just being in front of you, seriously, because you know what? There are employees, and then there are employees that really enjoy what they're doing. And I want to thank you for serving this great city because I've seen your work, and I think what I appreciate about you, you know, your uniform shows me you're the authority, but it's your attitude that gives me the respect for your uniform, and I want to thank you for that.
Thank you
Detective
very much.
Forrest, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Councilwoman Craig.
So at Deputy Chief Cassie McSorley's retirement, I believe there was a sort of an uttering under the breath that Sergeant John Murray on her last day had tried to slip in a $300,000 order for a bear cat at the very last minute on her last day. And she said, nice try. And I leaned over to Kelly and I said, are we paying $300,000 for something? And he said, not on your life. So one of the things that I really commend you is just looking at all of the alternatives. Great job. I do have one favor, and that is that you put that thing in the parades. I think that that's a great, put, you know, parking enforcement on it, or, you know, graffiti abatement or something, and that way maybe people will start to comply. But ultimately, I think that's a great, a great tool and a great community piece to be talked about and to be recognized, and you're to be commended for that. So thank you.
I agree. Thank you very much. I just want to also thank one last thing. I wanted to thank the city fleet maintenance guys for their hard work. They've done so much to that vehicle. It's unbelievable. Joe, Ron, and Alex, who are over there, I'd like to publicly thank them. They've done a great job on it, so they need to be commended.
My one comment will be, I think this may be a bad time to be a criminal. Because when you look out your front door, and there that sits, I'm not sure if hiding under the car with a police dog or knowing that that could drive through the front of your house. It may be a good time to change their behavior, and I want to thank you for your hard work on this. Thank you, Dale.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, now we start the rest of the show. We have public comment. There is a 2-minute restriction on the time. We may limit it further if we have multiple people talking on the same subject. I'm going to ask that we be respectful with each other. This is not a sporting event. This is not when we all get to cheer. We've got to do that for the outstanding presentation so far. If there's something already on the agenda, I'm going to ask you to wait and talk when that item comes up. We will now open the microphone for the public comment on anything that's not on the agenda.
Good evening. My name's Al Espadol. I was asked to make an announcement for a person that a good friend of mine, Joel Hernandez, who had to go to another meeting because of the hour of the night. Basically, he wanted me to remind everybody that the posadas that's taking place at the Costa Plaza is this Thursday from 3:30 to 6 p.m. It's a Christmas celebration at the Costa Plaza, and we invite all residents to participate at this event. You can bring children dressed up as St. Joseph, Virgin Mary, angels, or three magic kings. The celebration continues with traditional dance, piñatas, games, and more. And if you'd like more information, you can contact Hoyle on 831-710-5198, and they are continuing taking contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Al.
Ray DeLoe, I reside at 150 Kern Street, number 76. I'm here tonight for the Sherwood Lake Mobile Home Park Board of Directors. I have a letter that I'll be handing to the city clerk so that you can all have it, but Kern Street is a mess. That's the nicest way to describe it right now. We have traffic issues, and we have prostitution issues, and we like the city to clean the mess up. It's one thing for the young women and the transsexuals to be out there prating after dark, but when they start at 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning, and it runs all day long, there's something wrong with that. Truck traffic needs to be eliminated from Kern Street. Again, this week, they've knocked the barrier down at the end of the street, semi trying to turn around, and has knocked that barrier down. The big yellow posts that are down there, part of it's been demolished. So we're asking that the city would make an effort. We are spending about $100,000 just to make our park a little safer. We are making it a gated community. We've installed gates at the back. We're installing a gate is in process on the front right now. But we need your help too. It's common sense tells you what people are doing there. And the Shell station is the meeting place, right in the corner, in the dark. Not only are they turning tricks there, they are selling drugs there. And we would just like some help for our area there. We've got some very nice motels. We've got two restaurants and 150 homes in there. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, folks. Today I'm representing Old Town Salinas Foundation, of which I'm the president. As you know, the Old Town Foundation owns and operates various events throughout the year. Nine main events in Old Town that brings a lot of energy, vitality, people in a positive atmosphere. We do Easter egg hop, chili cook-off, which this year we're gonna add a salsa competition. And it's not just the eating salsa, it's actually the salsa dancing competition as well. We're doing a passport to Old Town. We do Halloween trick-or-treat, we do pub crawl for older people, Salinas Valley Food and Wine Festival, and we also do the Holiday Parade of Lights. We just finished. Amazing events. All these events are done with volunteers. Our 2014 team is getting assembled in the third week of January. Anyone here, anyone watching this on TV, we're looking for volunteers. We need help. Come join us. You can email us at oldtownfoundation@gmail.com. We need help organizing events and plan execution. If you want to volunteer and come help your old town better, email oldtownfoundation@gmail.com. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I'm Pamela Weston, and I've been going to the AB 109 meetings at the juvenile hall. I have a concern how that with our county running out of funds, except for jail expansion, that they hold the meetings before the public, because all that their AB 109 report showed by probation is failure. And I think that it should be held with the Board of Superintendents so others can be involved besides Second Chance, Turning Point, Social Services, Behavior Health, and everyone that isn't included. So I would like it to be moved to the Board of Superintendents or made to the public so we can deal with homelessness, health, and public safety.
Seeing no one else, I will now close public comment. We will come back to council members for reports, appointments, and future agenda items. And I will go to Councilwoman De La Rosa first.
Yes. I'd like to direct staff and our city manager on your concerns, Pastor. We'd like to have a meeting, go out there. We had talked about it. Chief McMillan, if we could, you know, work together on this and address the concerns of the pastor and that and of the residents and the businesses in that area. But also, we're having a community meeting tomorrow. Anyone interested on, again, the sites that the county has for you, for the sites that the county has designated for a possible juvenile hall? It's going to be at the community church, celebration by Smart and Final, Seamus, I think it's the name of the street, tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. So I invite anyone that's concerned about the juvenile sites tomorrow, please attend from starting at 7 o'clock.
Councilmember Barrera.
Mr. Mayor, if you would give me permission, I would like to welcome our new city attorney, Mr. Chris Callahan, please. I don't like embarrassing him, but he's a good man. He's a good man. We're in good hands there. Also, Mayor, last week I misspoke. I was out of turn. Usually I'm known for that, but I spoke out against PAL regarding the armory for a homeless shelter without really having my facts straight. So I want to apologize to PAL, to Officer Gonzalez, the firefighters, and everybody that's doing the good work. The armory still is not ready for occupancy. And I was critical of them last week, and this Saturday I happened to go by there, and there goes my shoe. No, I wear boots, so there goes my boot and my mouth. So I apologize to the good work. Just so you'll know, PAL has already invested close to $500,000 bringing up that building up to code. They're doing a great job. I salute them, and for the gifts that PAL, the Salinas firefighters, thanks to Chief Rodriguez, the firefighters took a Mexican Santa Claus to Cluster Park, and they gave about 500 to 800 gifts. Thanks to Hardin Foundation and the Salinas firefighters for the gifts. Also tomorrow, our senior citizens are celebrating the Happy Holidays at 11:30 p.m. at the Firehouse Recreation Center. I would invite all the department heads. I know they love when big shots go and visit them. So I'm sure they love to see the chiefs and the mayor and everybody in the departments. There's $5 for tamales. It's a good dinner. So that's at 11:30 tomorrow at the Firehouse Center. Also on so I won't forget, on Saturday, Dorothy's Place is also having their Christmas gifts. It's always an awesome tradition. It's great when, you know, people that are struggling, sometimes they have an opportunity to bring their kids and grandkids. It's fantastic to see families just having a great time and having a good meal together. We want to thank Dorothy's Place for that. And thank you, Mr. Mayor. That's all.
Councilwoman Craig.
Just a couple of quick updates. I did a ride-along for my third year anniversary of being sworn into council. I did a ride-along with the Violence Suppression Unit for our police department. And for those of you that don't know, the VSU department is kind of like our own city's gang task force. So we have a countywide gang task force and then the Violence Suppression Unit. And I have to tell you, I think there's, Chief, correct me if I'm wrong, eight officers in that department, or 10? Eight officers in that department. And I have to tell you, to my fellow council, what an incredibly educational experience that is. The amount of intel these guys have. I mean, driving down a road in the city and being able to be with two officers, one of which knows who, you know, the person is in the car, two cars ahead, behind us. He's got search and seizure rights. He's on parole. I've pulled him over 3 years ago. It's an incredible asset to our city. And so I would really encourage you not to bombard, you know, that particular unit. But if you have an interest, take a look and actually delve a little further. They are really, really smart guys and know what they're doing. Secondly, and I want to commend Sergeant Gray had to put up with me for a good portion of the evening asking all kinds of naive questions, so please thank him on my behalf. And then I wanted to note on a second part to that, if you would pass along the information, Chief. I participated long before I was a councilwoman. I was a Salinas JC, and they had their annual children's shopping tour this past Saturday. They took 450 children out to get school clothes from the city of Salinas. They raised $53,125 to do that. It's a nonprofit organization of 21 to 39-year-olds who have a commitment to give back to Salinas. That being said, I was in the middle of chaos pairing volunteers with children, and I looked up, and we had four officers from Salinas PD there on their own time wanting to take a child out. Two were in uniform and two were in plain clothes. All four came out on their own Saturday morning, and just an incredible tribute to four guys that could be doing something else, especially with their families and whatnot on a Saturday morning. So please thank Officer Jerry Magana, Gabe Gonzalez, Kendall Gray, and Kevin Oropeza for coming out on Saturday morning. That was pretty cool. Holiday home lighting. I've never known that there were 19 verses to We Wish You a Merry Christmas, but the Santa at Villa Sara was quick to point that out to me. So great experience. Had Tony and I shared a bus this year, and so we had the opportunity to get everyone together, and it was a great time. So hope we can continue that. And thank you to PG&E and Monterey Salinas Transit for making that happen. I'm currently dealing with a motel in District 5 that has some pretty significant code enforcement violations. We're working through that. Long-term tenants in a motel and trying to get that motel up to code and being sensitive to the needs of the residents that are there. So working pretty extensively behind the scenes on that. And then lastly, we have engaged Northridge Mall and Starwood, who are the new owners of Northridge Mall. And so have had some really great conversations with the COO. I have an appointment with the leasing agent, who's in charge of putting stores into Northridge Mall. So I'm pleased that they actually have a plan and an agenda for that mall, which is really, really encouraging. I think that we have the opportunity to bring that back to becoming a regional mall again. So that's it. Thank you.
Councilwoman Lutz.
Two quick items. First of all, I'm delighted to report that the Monterey County Board of Supervisors voted to accept the Solid Waste, Salinas Valley Solid Waste Authority's slight compromise to the that we're going to now work together to the county will stay in the Solid Waste Authority and we will be able to refinance the bonds. So that was great news. That happened at about 2:30 this afternoon, and it was a 3-1 vote. The second thing is I'm looking tomorrow forward to attending the Filipino luncheon at the Filipino Hall, and that is open to the public. So thank you.
Councilmember Castaneda.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. As of today, I have no appointments. As far as future agenda items, I know I looked at the 2014 schedule, and we have a very aggressive schedule to tackle, and I like the idea that the mayor shared with the council that we're looking at least two presentations or so to do per month. So I think that's going to go ahead and take us into mid-year. What I would like to add is something that I did not experience for this year, and it's something that we can calendar for maybe the quarterly within 3 or 6 or 9 months, and that's a joint meeting between the Board of Supervisors as well as the City Council. Only because there's many interrelated items. We're dealing with Department of Social Services that just goes into a wide array of different topics. We're dealing with the whole trash, the waste item as well. We can even look at joint building and land usage into if it's parks and recs, if it's the homeless shelters, everything. I think City Manager Ray Corpus is best equipped in regards to our mutual interest of agenda items. Maybe let's start very minimal, two or so. I think each one, regardless of the item, is going to be very comprehensive in itself. But if we can look in that direction. The other one happens to be more internal that we do have more control of, and that's the City Council looking at a joint meeting with the Measure V, or is it Measure E now, but Measure, the Oversight Committee. So we're looking at the oversight, and I recall when I did belong to the Oversight Committee, we've held numerous of those meetings throughout the year. I'm going to buddy up with Councilwoman Gloria De La Rosa on the speaker that came before us in regards to Kern Street, but not only Kern Street, just within that whole vicinity, and that is going to be more of a report. I don't want to presume, Chief. So I want I know your efforts are continuous, but if we can get some type of internal report, that's what I'm requesting under reports for council members, just to see what have been the different strategies that applied in that different zone. And I believe it does fall probably within the Suba district as well. Future agenda items, once again, I'm gonna go ahead and defer to the 2014 schedule. I think this is gonna be pretty much it for the 2013 month and year. Reports, that should conclude for myself. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. Councilmember McShane.
Sure. I've spoken with some of my colleagues up here about the idea of possibly restructuring the way the city goes about certain boards, commissions, and committees. We have these groups of really engaged people that help advise us on how to run the city. Now, some are duly necessary. Some would say maybe all, the Planning Commission, for example, Traffic and Transportation. But as some of these commissions aren't necessarily always meeting, and I know attendance has been a challenge, and the city has to keep up with all the minutes and administration of these things, I've kind of toyed with the idea that maybe we look at other cities and how they have maintained these types of advisory boards in certain circumstances and still kept people engaged but not had to, you know, put out the staff support. Almost like advisory boards to certain department directors. I've spoken with our new city attorney a little bit about this, and I think this could tie into at least one council member's request to investigate separating Parks and Rec from Library, that is two boards, if you will, and I think another council member's request to look at a senior commission, and interest that I've voiced for a neighborhood commission to help support and organize neighborhoods in the city. So this is a future agenda item request. I know I've spoken with, you know, kind of out there, and I've got a signed and buddied request here that I'll hand to our acting city clerk so we can look at that in the future. I can't tell you how energizing the holiday home lighting competition was for me. You know, we may not always agree as council members, but we all have the same goals and love for the city. And I got a lot of mistletoe here tonight. And there's some at the back of the room. There's some at the podium. I tried to litter this entire room with mistletoe. And I just want to really deliver a message to every single one of you in the audience that we're all here in Salinas, and we share Salinas. And this could be and will be and should be the season of love. And I just want to share that message with everyone. And no doubt, there couldn't have been a better man for the job. And you have my full support, Chris, as our new city attorney. So congratulations. I sat down with Municipal Auditing Services. Some of you have heard about them, read about them in the paper. I got the cell phone number if there's a certain reporter that would like to engage the owner of Municipal Auditing Services. But these are the guys that have been contracted by the city to do an audit of business licenses. I learned so much. You know, there's been two rounds. The first round, 08 through 11, they collected $1.4 million in business license revenue that had been overlooked. And in this last round, since February, it's been, I think, if I'm not mistaken, over $300,000. In fact, it was reported to me that there was one check for $240,000. And just recently, I think in the last few days, one came in for $40,000. Now, I think the badgering that's gone on with some of the folks that have been on the receiving end is a little harsh, but some of the success stories are really, really astounding. In fact, I think our city finance director said he handled at least 300 of these cases personally. I know it's a lot of nights and weekends, Matt, but at the end of the day, we are a tax-collecting agency, and your attention to detail and well, certainly the working relationship's appreciated. So on the 27th of January, there will be a public visit with Municipal Auditing Services. I'm working on a meeting of sorts, so stay tuned there. I want to acknowledge the council's work for the warming shelter. I'm very excited about it. You know, in fact, I took it upon myself to start collections at my place of business, and I'm going to actually continue to take collections in my city council office. So anybody that has personal items or blankets, socks, gently used clothes, please bring them to City Hall. And when City Hall's open and our council office is available, we'll take that collection and make them available. I want to acknowledge the city manager's work at a decorated weekly report. And I do hope that someday this will be publicly available, more readily available for the folks that really love our city and want to know what's going on in each of the departments. You know, a lot of cities are turning to more regular newsletters that kind of get the word out, and I think that would be helpful. A future presentation, perhaps. I'd love an update on the future growth area of the city. I recently ran into a developer that said at one point he had over 200 folks working for him in construction, and he's down to 20. And it's a real opportunity. I don't know how fast it's moving. I know there's other council members that are more engaged. I want to acknowledge our mayor writing for the Chamber of Commerce newsletter. I thought this was a good write-up on the Permit Center. It means a lot. I know it takes a lot of time for you to get out there and do that. And to at least one council member's interest in housing, jobs, balance, last week there was an AMBAG meeting. We voted. Some counties feel that they can export their requirements with the state when it comes to housing. And I'm proud to say that we really held the ground and ultimately with the colleagues that I sit on AMBAG with, we decided that the housing required of a city and of a county, more importantly, would stay local to that housing jobs balance. That's all, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank Channel 8 KSPW for their work with the Salvation Army this last weekend. They raised a tremendous amount of money that will stay in the community and go back to help people in need. Our own Councilwoman Gloria De La Rosa was very proudly on the phones. She was unmerciful. The people always gave extra, including me. She was on a mission, so.
You thank you.
So she came out and took good care of us. I want to thank three of the council members that have worked on the Salinas Valley Solid Waste Authority Agreement, Councilmember Barrera, Councilwoman De La Rosa, and Councilwoman Lutz. They've probably been to more meetings in Gonzales than ever imaginable, with numerous members of the Board of Supervisors and with the county CEO, and it appears as if our hard work will move forward now. So we are very thankful for their hard work. So you know, the city manager and myself have met with the county regarding some water issues and saltwater intrusion. We look forward to some more meetings. Some of those will be coming up soon. They'll be very public, and I think we all need to be aware of that issue. We've also had meetings with developers from the Allisal Marketplace that hopefully there'll be some good news coming out of that very soon. So there is a lot more going on. And I know that we don't like to acknowledge too many of the city employees or they'll want a pay raise, but I think Don Reynolds has been the heaviest lifter on the warming shelter. As all of you can see, he's a very quiet, humble man that's gone about this business with quite a passion. I had an opportunity to have lunch with him one day, and I didn't think he ever got down because he always has that little smirk like, I'm going to get that done. But he's hung in there for all of us, for the whole city, and I think that's what's really important. So now we're going to move on to consent agenda. There are four items, or actually there's five items on the agenda. Well, four because there's minutes have been tabled. Would any member of the council like an item pulled for discussion?
Item four. Five for question, please.
Item five, please.
Anyone else? We will now go to the audience. And anyone in the audience like an item pulled?
That's five.
Five.
Okay. Anyone else? Seeing none, we will now go back and we will pull item number four.
Thank you, Mayor. Just a couple of comments. One, I am going to express just a pet peeve of mine that cost allocation is broken down on a population basis. I think that really is, it harms Salinas. We're the city with the greatest population and the least afford, least able to afford the cost. $26,000, however, is fine. But I hope that whenever we are working with, and I will say this, I'm absolutely delighted that we're working with all 12 cities, with the county, with the Solid Waste Authority, and with the district. This is remarkable that we're all looking forward to figuring out how solid waste should be the run as a business and as an environmental concern. Gary, I just had to express my little pet peeve about the cost allocation. But I would also like to just highlight for the audience that what's really interesting about this and what's triggering this is that there is a substantial difference in tipping fees between the authority and the district. And part of the issue is that the authority has to close and maintain three landfills for 30 years, and that's very expensive. And we don't get money from the federal government to do that, and there wasn't enough money that came from either the county or the city. So that really has to be addressed. That's why the bond money was taken out, and also that the authority would like to give up landfills, would really like to work towards 100% recycling projects. So this is going to be a very significant step for our community, our whole county, to look at how do we deal with waste in this community. So this is going to be exciting, Gary. I'm looking forward to hearing the results, and thank you for taking the lead.
Thank you. Okay, now we're going to move to item number five, which seems to have spurred a tremendous amount of interest. We will go to Councilwoman Craig first.
Just a quick question. Certainly comfortable with the PREP agreement, but wondering, the council had talked about, as we move forward out into the community, to use a consistent instrument, or basically a questionnaire, amongst all of the council members for those meetings to ensure that we're asking all the same questions and making sure that we move forward and get kind of the same feedback for the same questions throughout the entire city. I'm wondering if TBWB Strategies would be willing to create that instrument or that questionnaire.
Yes, Councilman Craig, the proposed scope of work, there's 11 bullets under community outreach, and while they didn't specifically identify that example of like a questionnaire where they would solicit input from the community, it's definitely clear on multiple levels that they are would prepare materials related to the presentation, the messaging, you know, the information, so we can be consistent. And they use that word in their proposal, that it's with the focus on consistency, as we do the three-prong approach that was recommended, including the internal and external broad outreach, stakeholders with directed outreach with the information.
Great. I just I wanted clarification and frankly to put it on record a little bit that as we had given that guidance to be able to have those meetings just consistent that that the tools we use for those community meetings are provided by TBWB. So thank you.
Thank you.
I believe Councilmember McShane.
Sure. So two things. One, do you think it's enough money? City, it's a big election year, a lot going on.
So as far as enough money to do the scope of work
the
that
outreach,
they perform?
Yeah, the scope of work.
So this outreach really would take us from January through May, and in March there's another study session that we, the council at that point would direct staff on what to put on the ballot to begin to prepare the ballot language. And in May, last meeting in May, then we would actually, council would then vote on the specific language, and that, at that point it would be put on the ballot. We would submit it to the county or the registrar of voters. So the proposal is $6,500 a month from TBWB, and that's for their consulting services, and that would be 5 months, January through May. The extra cost that was added on would be for a one-time information mailer, and that would be 11 by 17, and with a tear-out response card where prepaid postage back, and that's also included. So the two components are listed there in the staff report. The $34,000, that would be for the consulting services for 5 months, and the $26,500 would be a not-to-exceed amount for that mailer.
Sure. Okay, so maybe just a few pieces of feedback. I think it'd be great, as with the survey that went out, there'd be an opportunity to engage either a subcommittee or all of the council members, or an opportunity to just, engage the council members and perhaps other constituencies on the best ways to talk to people about the many options that sit before us. I think I would concur with Councilmember Craig that there it benefit each of us as we plan community meetings to try to work towards some sort of consistency. It might even be worth, you know, having the consultants play a pretty large role in setting an agenda and just keeping it as consistent as possible so that any data or narrative collected is consistent. Also, I mean, you know, as much as folks read mail, there's a growing constituency that isn't as dependent on mail. And I know it provides a lot of value when you get the tear out and everything. But glossy mailers, 26,000, I'm much more of a boots on the ground type of a guy. And we see some of the success with the economic element that came about. I think there could be a lot of ideas there. So my only hope would be that as staff considers what lies ahead as this passes, that premium be placed on engaging people, organizations, grassroots, as opposed to just glossy mailers and sitting back and waiting for the cards to come back. You know, the only last thing I think that would be helpful is a timeline as well, Matt, how this plays into a much larger plan. You know, assuming the city is planning for something to happen next November, and a revenue measure is what is being planned for. What are the various steps, and how do you see that playing out? You know, just a memo that very simply prepares all of us, and I think some at the dais are better prepared than others. Some have been through this probably three or four times, as they've been on the council over a decade. But other you know, council members haven't been through a revenue measure, win, lose, or draw. So, again, thanks. That's
thanks.
All.
Thank you.
Now we'll go to the audience. We had two gentlemen in the audience who would like to address this issue. I didn't see your hand, but I'll let you talk anyway, sir.
Ray DeLow, 150 Kern Street. I think the cart is before the horse. I'm not sure why we're going to spend upwards of almost $60,000 unless the council is telling us already they've decided what type of a tax measure they're going to be seeking. If that's the case, please let all of us know. But I have asked, and it's been, hopefully is going to be agendized, that we would have a presentation for a special tax. That's a group of people who have been working for a year. And I would appreciate that the council would hear that presentation before we spend another $55,000 on fancy mailers and those types of things. At least let us have an opportunity to present to you what we have found out from our community. That, I think, would be best for Salinas as a whole and would be to the council's benefit also. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
My name is Wayne Schapper. I think you probably all know me. As a bit of introduction, I would like to mention that in my 27 years with the Salinas Police Department, I worked extensively with reading and studying and creating statistics. And I also chaired the redistricting committee for the city a couple years ago, which dealt extensively with statistics. And as I say that, I want to mention that I have some problems with the statistics that the survey produced. There were 26 responses possible in the survey that they did. Five were not included in the report that they gave the city council. I wonder why that was. If you look at those five, the numbers were lower than any of the other ones. All the ones that were presented to you were above 70% approval. Those were below 70%. An interesting feature also was the fact that in one of the two groups, the approval for a new police facility was 78%. One of the items that was not included showed 69% for a new police facility. That's a big difference. I wonder why that is. Was there a difference in the demographics of the two groups? I think that should be studied before you spend any more money with FBWB to find out whether their methodology that they presented to you was proper. Another thing that came to mind when I was looking at the details, one of the groups had potholes mentioned twice, once only in the other group. Did this have an effect on the overall results of the percentages that showed? And finally, there are mentions of Tier 1 and Tier 2 in the report to the council. There's nothing in the report that TBWB provided that says what Tier 1 and Tier 2 are. So in light of that, I think there needs to be some more study of what was presented to you before you decide to spend more money on that company. Thank you.
As it looks now, there'll be a 1 cent sales tax measure on the ballots next year. Two forms this can take. It's either a special tax or general tax. A special tax, however, is the only one that can claim to be focused on police, fire, and safety. A general tax cannot make such a claim. it is against the state of California Constitution to call a general tax be focused on public safety. It goes in a general pot, gets divided up anyway, and then every year, then-present council members spend it the way they want it, from year to year. It is not a guarantee for public safety. I think we should remember the lessons learned from the failed Measure K campaign, the Penny for Peace Initiative. In that city commissioned a poll similar to the one we heard in October that said 63% of the voters supported 1% general tax, and council put a 1% general tax in the ballot. However, this was defeated on election day with only 39.29% vote. Wow. What happened? The poll said otherwise. Well, the arguments were clear. The Measure K did not require a penny to be spent on public safety. Measure K would have lasted forever, had no sunset. And Measure K was a blank check because it was a general tax. These were the arguments made in 2009 that defeated Measure K. There is no evidence to believe that city's general electorate has gone through a radical change of mind. These three arguments are still valid. Once again, a public safety tax measure that is focused on suppression, prevention, and intervention for crime in the city of Salinas, in addition to focusing on fire and code enforcement, is the direction that between 78 and 79% of the citizens want to go. We urge you once again to allow the Public Safety Committee make a full presentation to the council so you may know all the beautiful facets of what we're thinking of proposing. Thank you.
Good evening again. My name is Al Espindola. I just wanted to speak on this item in support of moving forward. I'm not going to get up here and debate on the tax as to what type it will be. Because we all know what we need to do, and that is to generate revenue for the city. And I do trust the council, the mayor, those sitting up there to make the right choices in regards to the funds that are provided to them moving forward. And I can tell you the TBWB group have impressed me in the past. Statistics are just what they are, statistics. You can challenge them till the cows come home. And the previous speaker spoke about Penny for Peace, Measure K. Yeah, that failed. The Measure V was successful. It was a general tax. And it did real well in getting rid of its sunset clause. I think the public's ready, and I hope you guys are ready too. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, Mayor, if I may, we're on number 5. For
yes.
Clarification, as a member of the council, I'd like to go ahead and request a separate vote on that number 5.
Okay.
City Clerk, if you'll call for the vote.
Mr. Mayor, would it be okay before we vote? If it's okay.
Sure.
Thank you, sir. Being that, you know what, we work for the people of Salinas, and of course, in every issue, there's differences. But to what Pastor Ray DeLoy, I would like to ask the finance director, would it be a negative impact if we do wait on this issue? Of course, we have to vote, but is there a rush that we can't wait before he or whoever makes their presentation?
Thank you, Councilman. In the staff report, I indicated the time sensitivity of this, and basically we, with March 23rd study session coming up, yeah, and then the May, there is quite a bit of work to begin to engage. And before the March 23rd or 21st study session, we are really looking for the community to give input on more focused on priorities. In the past, the community has identified the need and said, these are the needs. Now we're seeking additional input to, all right, we recognize the needs. Now, what are the priority? And party-based budgeting plays into it. There's going to be online surveys related to this. We're going to engage community with open forum meetings. There's going to be the target. So to accomplish all that before March, we should get started. That would be my recommendation, that we not wait. Thank you.
Thank you.
City Clerk, if you'll call for the vote on items 2, 3, and 4, and 5 will be a separate vote.
Councilmember Barrera.
Aye.
Councilmember Castañeda.
Yes.
Councilmember Craig.
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa.
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz.
Aye.
Councilmember McShane. Yes. Mayor Gunter.
Aye. Now, if we'll call for the vote on item number 5.
Councilmember Barrera.
Aye.
Councilmember Castañeda?
No.
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Mayor Gunter?
Aye. We will now move to the administrative report section, where Salinas Downtown Community Action Board teams update. And we're going to receive a report from the Archangel of the Homeless People, Don Reynolds, the project manager.
Archangel, that puts me on top of the Christmas tree, huh, Mayor? Target, pardon me. Thank you, Mayor Gunter, and thank you for all of your comments tonight. I appreciate that. We have two items on the agenda tonight, and specifically, you'll see soon why Chinatown is addressed in a report separate from the homeless. And there's are important reasons for that. We had a terrific rehearsal for this meeting with our ad hoc committee, Councilmember Gloria De La Rosa, Jill Lutz, and Councilmember Castañeda. And when we rehearsed our presentation, we managed to do it in 90 minutes, and I promise tonight will be shorter. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, moving right along. Okay, I'm going to give an introduction of our work very briefly, and then I'm going to introduce our downtown community board and members of our, at least three of our action teams are here tonight to present an update, and then CSUMB also has some slides that they'd like to share from their close to 10-year commitment to our Chinatown work. So moving forward, if I can find the right one. Okay, how about this color? Nope, that doesn't work either. All right. Is it this one? Liz, which one is it? Is it this one? It's not working. Okay. Well. Sorry about that. Okay, we got it. All right. We've been working since 2005 diligently in Chinatown. We have a 2007 vision plan. And we also have our more current 2010 Chinatown Rebound Plan. And that is the basis of our work in Chinatown at this point. It was an in-depth study of the resources in Chinatown and the needs. And that started with a review of our historic routes and the needs to identify our historic elements and stabilize and rehabilitate our historic buildings. We also looked at economic development, and insightful consulting helped us identify our catalyst sites, shown in this map as the haciendas to the north on Rossi Street, the city-owned property towards the center, the Republic Cafe, and the parcel to the south, which used to be the Shell Station, and then the parcel to the far west, which is, as I'll show shortly, the destination for our social services campus. So these are the roots of the element. We studied reconnecting Chinatown. We studied bicycle and pedestrian at grade crossings, returning one-way streets to two-way streets and connecting the ITC. Of big importance to us is our social services center, the Bridge Street Social Services Campus. We interviewed 150 homeless people and came together with a complete analysis of what the needs would be and what a campus would look like on the west side of Chinatown here in this yellow section. to address both the health needs and the welfare needs and the employment needs of our population. So the point was, let's come up with a plan, and we did, that describes the economic revitalization of Chinatown, yet caring for the neediest people in the community. And that is the gist of our 2010 Chinatown Rebound Plan. And we know what happened to redevelopment and the funding, and so we're still working hard to get that moving forward. So on our catalyst development sites identified earlier, we do have the Rossi Street Housing Project that we fondly refer to as Neomachi Village on the location of what used to be Japantown. We've been working hard with Mid-Peninsula Housing for a proposal on our 0.8 acres of property where the garden exists today. We're moving forward as best we can with the acquisition of 10 Soledad Street, approved by the county on December 10th, and moving forward to the state for approval. And we're also looking at other properties there. And there's been a lot of work done at the Republic Cafe by our Asian community, Asian cultural experience team. So for 2014, we were successful in getting CIPs approved to codify this plan. If I can get it to work. Our plan will create a form-based zoning code on 29 acres that will help us implement the land use as described here. And the reason that's important is because even now, if we wanted to open the Republic Cafe as a museum as proposed, we wouldn't have the parking or the other features necessary to accommodate that. So we are recommending that we start with that CIP, and then look at our two-way streets, returning our one-way streets to two-way streets, work on site control to initiate the services center, and continue to acquire properties as we can, and of course support our housing developers. And with that, I'll move into the status of our downtown community board. We have five action teams. The public relations team, I will talk about. Reconnection Action Team is working most closely right now with our vibrancy plan and looking at how all of our downtown connects to each other, as well as connecting philosophically and staying connected with our social services and our other partners in the region. And then our Safety, Sanitation, and Security Committee is really stems from a 15 to 18 year program that's been run from the Buddhist Temple. Our Chinatown Homeless Action Team and Asian Cultural Experience. And are there members? There are members here from our Downtown Community Board. We have Jim Barnes is here. He was recently appointed as our new co-chair, replacing Tom Melville. And are there other members? Ruben is here from our Safety Committee. Kathy Young is here, our new treasurer. If you guys could stand up, that would be great. And Eugene Begay, Jeff Pollack from CSUMB. And Jill, who is still sitting down. Okay. Moving right along. Sorry. This is our new website, and this is the pride and joy of our public relations team. It's here at this website that you're able to find the 2010 plan and the current events and calendars of the Downtown Community Board. And this is a key tool for us, especially for the city council and the community, because the plan is lengthy and it's hard to hand someone a hard copy of this huge document. But here you can refer them to the link, they can look it up and they can see what the current events are in our Chinatown and in our downtown community board. So this is where our information is centrally located. And then I'll move right along. Ruben, did you want to talk to the Safety Committee? I have just two slides if you want to talk about the activity of the Safety Committee. Thank you. And then Jill will help us with an update on our chat team. And then Wellington Lee and Kathy Chavez-Miller are here from our ACE team. And then Dr. Pollack and Professor Benmayor will talk about our Soledad team. So what I've got here is just a summary from our list.
Sure. Thanks, Ruben. Again, my name is Ruben Cortez. Wear a number of hats. I co-chair the Salinas Downtown Community Board and also chair the Safety, Sanitation, Security. We meet once a month. And to go over some of the highlights that we have in 2013, one of them is we meet on, like I said, on a monthly basis, and I'm proud to say that a member of the Salinas Police Department normally attends. Sometimes they have emergencies and then they can't attend, but they're almost always present, specifically Commander Dave Crable. He's done a good job, you know, really applaud his effort. With the sweeps that we've had, sometimes they, at first, they were a little bit difficult, but throughout the year, it seems like more gentle sweeps have been taking place. And another highlight that we've had, although it's not in existence anymore, is the plush program. And what that was an effort to have a community restroom. However, because it's not in existence, we've had some items that we had to correct, and we're going to try to initiate it again. But it's a challenge. Believe me, it's a real challenge. Some of the priorities that we have for 2014 are as follows. Okay, for 2014, we're going to develop strategies to engage the police to do community policing. Like I said, it's a challenge. Chinatown is a very tough nut to crack, but I think we can do it. Commander, or actually now Chief of Police Kelly McMillan, actually used to attend some of our safety committee meetings, so I know that he's aware of some of the challenges that we do have. But you believe me, you got the right man for the job here as chief. So, you know, we'll see progress. Second, we'd like to engage civic leaders as using lack of funds and as an ongoing excuse for inconsistently addressing crime in the neighborhood. I know that funding isn't always an issue, and it seems like whenever we have problems in Chinatown, it comes down to lack of funds or having enough officers to take care of the situations. But with the proposed tax, hopefully that might not be an issue anymore. And we'd like to invite the police to walk the beat in Chinatown, hopefully stop by Dorothy's Kitchen and other establishments. That's kind of like building a trust amongst the neighborhood and having some public engagement. Number four, we like to advocate and lobby for funding from any proposed 1 cent ballot tax measure in next year's election. Number five, engage another Salinas Downtown Community Board action teams in reference to encampments, sanitation, and things of that sort. And number six, we'd like to, revisit the plush program. It's a difficult situation, but hopefully we'll, with the experience that we've had, hopefully we'll come to a better outcome this time. And with that, with other teams that make up our board, we hope to collaborate with them to solve the homeless issues. So thank you very much, and I'll hand it back to Don.
Thank you, Ruben. I'd like to move on to our chat team, and Jill Allen offered to help us present this. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Jill Allen. I'm the interim executive director of the Franciscan Workers of Junipero Serra, operating Dorothy's Place in the Chinatown area. And I'm honored to present our highlights for the Chinatown Homeless Action Team, which we affectionately refer to as CHAT. Our 2013 highlights we're very proud of an ongoing, well-attended monthly meeting effort that further coordinates and collaborates service providers and other stakeholders in the area. Regular participants include the Franciscan Workers, Interim Inc., CSUMB Learning Center, Sun Street Centers, Monterey County Housing Authority, the Coalition of Homeless Services Providers, and Mid-Penn Housing. To address the great need that has been observed during our quarterly safety sweeps, we have successfully provided quarterly Chinatown barbecues as a means of outreach and engagement and relationship building with our neighbors that are living on the streets. More than 200 of our neighborhood residents are served lunch at each barbecue, and many are engaged in services, with more than 10 agencies participating in street outreach. CSUMB provides engagement training at each event to support these outreach workers and provides an opportunity for debriefing and reflection for staff after the event. This is innovative in that it not only supports the outreach workers, but it also helps mentor other social service providers in the ways and means needed to proactively work with our residents that are out there on the streets. And we have provided a very thoughtful forum to discuss and support MidPen Housing Corporation's proposed 90-unit permanent supportive housing project in Chinatown. And I'm trying to figure out what to do with this. Is that it? Oh, I feel so empowered. CHAT's priorities for 2014. We would like to improve the street outreach and engagement both during and after our quarterly barbecues, making sure that data and information is captured and reported consistently. And I would, at this point, like to pause and invite the City Council to come to our next quarterly barbecue, which is actually an indoor barbecue due to the season. It will be occurring this Friday, this coming Friday, from around 11 to 2 p.m. It will be over at the Buddhist Temple of Salinas in their multipurpose room, their big gym. And I would also like to thank the service providers that are joining us, the Franciscan workers in that effort, but also the Garnica family who has taken it upon themselves to enlist all of their family members, their friends, and their friends' family members to come and volunteer for the event and make that happen this coming Friday. On to our priorities for 2014. We would want to work even more closely with the other Salinas Downtown Community Board action teams regarding safety, security, and sanitation issues and the many other things that come up for discussion. We would like to engage the fire marshal regarding better and safer access to buildings on Soledad Street. We would like to continue a discussion of encampment alternatives in conjunction with the city and other Salinas Downtown Community Board action teams. For example, transitional self-help encampments for our homeless residents, coordinated with consumers and other stakeholders. We would like to assertively further the development of a human services campus on Bridge Street as envisioned in the Chinatown Renewal Plan that you just saw a couple of minutes ago. Beginning with the acquisition of the Chevron property on Bridge Street, very important. We would like to advocate for and continue to support for a continued support for the proposed MidPen Chinatown Permanent Supportive Housing Project. And in partnership with the community relations team, develop position papers regarding homeless issues and other issues and share with the City Council, with the Old Town Salinas Association, with local property owners, community members, and other interested parties. So with that, I'm going to conclude for chat, and I would like to introduce Wellington Lee. Is Wellington here? Or Kathy? Okay. Wellington Lee, with our Asian cultural experience, which started as a committee of the Salinas Downtown Community Board, but now is a 501c3 nonprofit corporation in its own right. And they've had a lot of successes this year.